Hello children, welcome to our English class. I hope you all must be doing good. Children, today we would be reading Unit 4, The Wonder Years, Section 2, The Scholarship Jacket, written by Marta Salinas. Children, first let us know about the author Marta Salinas. Marta Salinas was born in Coalinga, California and received a degree in creative writing from the University of California at Irvine. The Scholarship Jacket is one of several short stories Salinas has published in journals and collections. Now let's come to page 139 of your textbook, section 2, The Scholarship Jacket. Children, what does the term scholarship refer to? Scholarship is a grant or an award or a payment made to support a student's education, or you can say an award given on the basis of academics or other achievements so that a person can easily pursue further education. Children, let me ask you a very simple question. What, according to you, a dream refers to? A dream refers to a desire, an aspiration, a goal or a vision, isn't it? All of us have dreams, either a dream of winning a competition, a dream to come first in the class, a dream to become the class monitor, or a dream to be a millionaire. And to fulfill or achieve one's dream, one has to put in a lot of effort to make it happen. But children, if something hinder the achievement of your dream, or obstacles that block your progress, or you have been offended or deprived of either an award or a position which you have longed for or deserved it, how will you cope up with such a situation? Are you going to fight for your rights? Or are you going to take up any unfair means? So today we are going to read a similar story, The Scholarship Jacket, which is one of the best known stories by Marta Salinas. It describes a difficult situation that Marta, the central character of the story, a Mexican-American girl from Texas, faced after she earned excellent grades in school. Marta, a 14-year-old highly spirited girl, aspires to fulfill her dreams but became a victim of discrimination and was distinguished. The following story is about a brilliant student who learned from her wise grandfather how important it is to stand by your principles, and that rewards are truly meaningful when they are earned through hard work and not bought with money. The small Texas school that I went to had a tradition implemented yearly during the 8th grade graduation. Children, here implemented means to put into action, carried out. A beautiful gold and green jacket, the school colors, was awarded to the class valedictorian. The student who had maintained the highest grades for 8 years. The scholarship jacket had a big bold S on the left front side and your name written in gold letters on the pocket. My oldest sister, Rosie, had won the jacket a few years back and I fully expected to also. Children, the small Texas school where Marta went, every year as part of their school's tradition, a scholarship jacket was presented to the class valedictorian. Valedictorian, children, is an outstanding student who delivers the main speech at the graduation ceremony where the degrees are given out. Or you can say a person who has scored the highest grade in his or her graduation class. Okay? So now, the jacket is a beautiful gold and green color, which the school awards to the best performing student in academics for consecutive 8 years of brilliance. The jacket had a big gold S printed on the left front side, and below it the name of the awardee is written with gold letters on the pocket. Martha expects to be given the honor as she enters her 8th grade, just like her sister Rosie did in the past. Okay children, let's read the next paragraph. I was 14 and in the 8th grade. I had been a straight A grade student since the first grade, and this last year had looked forward very much to owning that jacket. My father was a farm laborer who couldn't earn enough money to feed 8 children. So when I was 6, I was given to my grandparents to raise. We couldn't participate in sports at school because there were registration fees, uniform costs, and trips out of town. So, even though our family was quite agile and athletic, there would never be a school sports jacket for us. This one, the scholarship jacket, was our only chance. Martha was 14 and in the final year of her graduation. Throughout her school life till grade 8, she has been a meritorious student and have always looked forward attaining the scholarship jacket. She had a tough life. She comes from a family of 10 members. Her father was a farm laborer who couldn't satisfy the needs of her children, so she was given to her grandparents to raise. Her grandfather runs a farm and tries hard to educate her. She is also not very beautiful or athletic, so academic honor was the only thing that she found alluring. Children, now let's read the last paragraph. In May, close to graduation, spring fever had struck as usual with a vengeance. Spring fever refers to a feeling of restlessness and excitement felt as winter ends, and with a vengeance means strongly. No one paid any attention in class. Instead, we stared out the windows and at each other, wanting to speed up the last few weeks of school. I despaired every time I looked in the mirror. Pencil thin. Not a curve anywhere. I was called beanpole and string bean, and I knew that's what I looked like. A flat chest, no hips, and a brain. That's what I had. That really wasn't much for a 14-year-old to work with, I thought, as I absent-mindedly wandered from my history class to the gym. Another hour of sweating in basketball and displaying my toothpick legs was coming up. Then I remembered my PE shorts were still in a bag under my desk, where I had forgotten them. Children, this paragraph describes the end of the session, where the few weeks of the school were left and the children were in no mood to attend the classes. So either they looked out of the windows or looked at each other just to pass their time. Then the description of Martha has been given. She was very skinny and she was pencil thin. People used to call her by names such as beanpole or a string bean. She had a flat chest, no hips, but a brilliant brain. Martha was thinking about all this in a distracted manner when she was going from her history class to the gym. Another hour of sweating in basketball and displaying my toothpick legs was coming up. After playing basketball for 1 hour and displaying her very thin legs, she remembered she has forgotten her shorts in a bag under her desk, and then she moved back all the way to get them. Now children, come to page 140. I had to walk all the way back and get them. Coach Thompson was a real bear if someone wasn't dressed for PE. She had said I was a good forward and even tried to talk Grandma into letting me join the team once. Of course, Grandma said no. Coach Thompson was a difficult person to deal with, and she is very particular about students being dressed up properly for PE. She had even once asked grandmother to let me join the team, the basketball team, as according to her, I am a good forward. But of course, grandma said no to her. I was almost back at my classroom door when I heard voices speaking angrily, as if in some sort of argument. I stopped. I didn't mean to eavesdrop. I just hesitated, not knowing what to do. I needed those shots and I was going to be late. But I didn't want to interrupt an argument between my teachers. I recognized the voices. Mr. Schmidt, my history teacher, and Mr. Boone, my maths teacher. They seemed to be arguing about me. I couldn't believe it. I still remember the feeling of shock that rooted me flat against the wall, as if I were trying to blend in with the graffiti written there. When Martha reached the classroom door, she overheard a conversation going on between her two teachers, Mr. Schmidt and Mr. Boone. She did not want to listen to the conversation going on secretly. She just required her shots as she was getting late for her classes. But she was shocked and badly in a fix when she came to know that the argument was going on regarding her only. She couldn't believe it. She still remembered the feeling of shock that rooted her flat against the wall, as if she was a part of the graffiti written there. I refuse to do it. I don't care who her father is. Her grades don't even begin to compare to Martha's. I won't lie or falsify records. Martha has a straight A+ average, and you know it. That was Mr. Schmidt, and he sounded extremely angry. Mr. Boone's voice sounded calm and quiet. Look, John's father is not only on the board. He owns the only store in town. We could say it was a close tie. And Martha's world turns upside down when she came to know that the talking was about the jacket, the scholarship jacket, and how it should go to her classmate John, who stood second to Martha, just because John's father was an influential man. Mr. Schmidt refused to make any alterations or to falsify the records, the grades. He even did not bother who John's father was. According to him, Martha should be the scholarship jacket. The pounding in my ears drowned out the rest of the words. Only a word here and there filtered through. Martha is Mexican. Resign. Won't do it. Mr. Schmidt came rushing out and, luckily for me, went down the opposite way toward the auditorium. So he didn't see me. Shaking, I waited a few minutes and then went in and grabbed my bag and fled from the room. Mr. Boone looked up when I came in, but didn't say anything. To this day, I don't remember if I got in trouble in PE for being late or how I made it through the rest of the afternoon. I went home very sad and cried into my pillow that night, so Grandma wouldn't hear me. It seemed a cruel coincidence that I had overheard that conversation. Martha, after hearing the conversation going on between the two teachers that was regarding her only, was totally shattered. She was broken, and she now knew it very well that very few chances are left for her to get the scholarship jacket. Just on the grounds of being a Mexican and John being a Caucasian, she was not given her rights. Very upset after hearing something that she has never ever thought of. It seemed a cruel coincidence that she had overheard that day. It was something that happened by chance. So children, that's all for today. I would be meeting you in my next video with the remaining portion of the story. So thank you for watching. Take care.